नमस्ते लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, इंडिविजुअल्स इन वेरियस डोमेन्स। एंड इंडिविजुअल्स इन देयर रेस्पेक्टिव डोमेन्स। लेट मी टेक दिस सब्जेक्ट मच फर्दर to the deeper understanding of the subject as to what exactly rishis, munis or brahma rishis had that ideology. Though I am still in the basic understanding and giving the brief introduction about emergence of Natyashastra to get into picture, because this has close relationship with understanding of three concepts. One is religion aspect, understanding of the Hinduism, and the science of spirituality. The science of spirituality, science of Hinduism, and science of religion as a single entity, which has its own broader mission. The point is, why am I comparing it with dance and music or the art and culture to this? Should be the first question that scholars or the persons or the individuals who are aspiring to be classical dancers need to know. The point is, today whole of the Natya Shastra or doctrine for dance as a whole has come to such an extent that it is being mocked. When I say mocked, it's as simple as that. No dancer is really understanding the practical theology or the practical inference or the practical approach or the understanding of rishis, munis and brahma rishis behind the shrutis that were being told through air to the common people in Prakritika Bhasha or the language. When I say language, it was like based on the science of sound, and which these people could understand through the intuition, irrespective of understanding the core concept of existence of religion, existence of Hinduism as one concept, and spirituality being the backbone for both of this. Point is, what really were the determinants or the factors or the cofactors for this? I felt like talking about it because we really are failed in this, and that is the reason why today dance, though it is considered as a divine aspect is not happening the way it has to. Point is very simple. What I'm trying to drive over here is, we are not thriving for that. Thriving to understand whole, understanding of the whole as a, you know, universal truth. We know that it is more or less talking about Prakriti or the Purusha. You have to understand this to the core. Now, there are two extremes to this. If we take Hinduism, Hinduism is not based on the four Vedas. Rigveda, Yajurveda, Atharvana Veda, Sama Veda. But prior to even breaking this, Hinduism as a single word had a broader meaning. Today, the individuals, due to their due to their insanity, they are not understanding sanely about the basic understanding about that conceptual understanding. Existence, its core part of it. During that period of time, social structuring was not so vast as it is today. When compared to billions of people, billions and trillions existing today, it was maybe below a lakh or something like that. It was like Indic culture or Indus Valley civilization, which had its own core belief system. It is like, you know, we are narrowing it down ourselves with a dogmatic approach. When I say dogmatic, it's a dogmatic approach that we are having. The apathy part is this, unfortunately. As I keep on telling, I have still not touched the Natya Shastra as it. I'm still speaking about the Shastras and Shastras' existence. Understand this. If Shastra's existence itself is so vast like an uphill task, if we come to Natya Shastra, how vast it would be. We need to understand this. I am emphasizing on this. This emphasizing is very much important. The social dimensions during that period of time were open. And right now they are very much rigid. They are not open enough. They are being exploited. Rather than exploring the concept, our individuals in the current scenario are imploring that. There is a lot of difference between exploring and imploring. In exploration, what happens is you tend to go there and you tend to look at it and you experience it and you do the best and you get the best out of it and you give it to the society. And you show this is what is the thing all about. In imploring, you just look at it. You don't really try to explore that. You don't try to exploit that subject as such. And on top of it, we have egocentric individuals who are giving their own explanation. Due to that, what happened? Natya Shastra or Shastras had their own versions. 10 different. I'm giving you an example or approximate numbers. It is just 10 that has come out. But factually, if I see, there will be n number of subjects. And this Natya Shastra fortunately came out with one specific subject in 2nd century CE. And comprehensive visioning of the spirituality and philosophy is far, far, far steps away from it. This was what the vision that they had. They were quite near to that. The seers or rishis, Brahma rishis, who had those shrutis, had that, listened to that shruti. Fortunately, 2,000-3,000 years back, they recorded it as the smritis. And it had a wider vision. Today, unfortunately, I don't really think so. We are able to think to any extent, at least touching upon the base point, not 1% of the base level subject. Everyone are egocentric. Everyone have their own... sorry about that. Everyone have their own vision. Everyone have their own thoughts inculcated. We are great, we are great. But when it comes to Shastras, it should not be that way. This was what the clear-cut vision of rishis and Brahma rishis who heard to the Shrutis, which got converted to Smritis. Today, if I speak to scholars or if I speak to PhD holders who are holding doctorates, they have their own versions. And I really fail to understand, are they really getting into the core concept of the subject? I in fact tried to talk about the subject with many of them, but most of them failed to justify me with their explanation. It's not their fault. It's the age-old practice, it's the centuries practice that has come into picture. And that's the way they were brought up. And that's the way they had that understanding of the subject. Maybe I might be like demeaning, but I'm not trying to demean or I'm not trying to find fault with the current scholars or the people who are holding doctorates in their respective domains. My only point over here is, what I am trying to emphasize is, we are failing to understand the in-depth analysis and the deeper aspect of the subject. And I am time and again telling, I have not still touched the Natya Shastra as such. I'm still stuck at Shastra's existence and its emergence situation, which I felt it was necessary to be told. Now, when it comes to the approachability and refinery aspect of the subject of science, spirituality and philosophy, the objectivity and subjectivity of the core concept was exactly there during that period of time, and that was what told to it, and that was what told as the Shrutis, and that is what has been inculcated in the Smritis in the form of words. However, there have been different proponents which are also key for the same. And in fact, with the Brahma Rishi Bharata, who had written Natya Shastra, as per records or as per the evidence present with us. I will not take that as a conclusive evidence or the conclusive part, because I don't agree that it was Bharata who has written. Because, however, prior to even this Natya Shastra, there were many Natya Shastras that came, which I will be talking about in some time, which I have that information with me. Bharata was just a person who had deciphered in the form of Smritis, collecting those Shrutis for the beneficiary of the individuals and society to form that as a doctrine text. However, there have been many people who have come and explained in their own version during that period of time. But still, the point is, they never deviated from the concept of the subject as a whole. They in fact work with the single entity in a more broader sense and vivid sense. The point is, are we really failing in this, or have we failed in this? Is one of the questions that one needs to ask to himself or herself, whoever are posing themselves as holding doctorates, or whoever is like trying to, you know, think about it. The point is, where are we going? Which direction are we going? What is the direction? Are we like getting misled? All of this gamut of Natya Shastra or the Shastras, which was clearly told or clearly has been clearly documented in the form of Smritis by deciphering the Shrutis that were told 10,000 years back. As I keep on telling, Nasadiya Sutta, talk about Nasadiya Sutta and Hiranyagarbha Sutta. The point is, today, most of the scholars or research scholars, individuals, seers, or someone who is giving lectures on this philosophy and spirituality are so self-deluded that they give their own explanation to them, leaving the base study of it. And some of them even delude that core concept of the subject at the organic level. When I say organic level, natural, it has to come at a natural level. All these Shrutis were natural. And unfortunately, we are missing on the natural version or natural voice that came from the air. Are we doing justice to this? Is what is the question that I am asking. Natya Shastra or the nine forms of dance, nine forms of the bhakti or Navanida bhakti, meditation, yoga therapy, dance, music being the core part of it, are really losing their edge over this. This is really sad to say. I am not being rude, I am not being harsh to the scholars or the research scholars or the eminent people who are in the dance form. I would blame it to the historians who have created this environment. For centuries, it has been passing by centuries, it has come to everyone, all of them. There is no other go for scholars or research scholars or the individuals who are practicing Vedas and Upanishads or trying to understand at their own level. Though they are being self-deluded and deluded and they are not organic at all, I agree with that. The point is, we are missing on this. We have missed on this. And this is what is the primal importance of understanding Shastras from the viewpoint of the Shrutis. Maybe you may find, you may not find. However, let's take the other aspect of this. Today, religion is being abused consistently at a higher level. Though I am having sacred thread, please, I am not a Brahmin at all. Because I didn't understand Brahman concept at all. Brahmanism or Brahmanical rites needed to be understood by an individual. Just because I am doing rituals, just because I am performing Gayatri Japa, just because I am doing Lingabhishekha or any other things, doesn't mean I am what you call spiritually enlightened or I am devoted. Devotion has a different meaning altogether. Brahmanism means a different concept altogether. We need to understand that. This is one of the primary qualities, or this is one of the primary aspects that one who is following the nine forms of devotions or Navanida Bhakti, wherein I am talking about yoga, meditation, dance, music as primary focal points or the factors that lead one to the self-realization point, is the true religion. There is no caste or creed. It is we who have created that. As the period, as the years passed by. There is a saying, whole of the heart, the heart of religion is not in talks, mastering the scriptures. It is in realization point, the self-realization part. Realization is the cornerstone of tradition. Belief, intellectualization are the cofactors, or they don't really mean anything in this part. One needs to have the first-hand experience when he or she is trying to understand the spirit of the traditional art forms. Because traditional art forms, be it dance, classical dance, or the semi-classical dance, or the music, or yoga, or meditation, is to be understood. And the point over here is, one gets to understand, if one gets to understand the self-realization, or whatever he reaches that level, he or she reaches that level, he will be aloof. He will be totally different. At the same time, he or she will be able to understand the core concept of the subject. Thus, I conclude this video with the pointers, or the factors, or the cofactors for the same understanding of scriptures or smritis from the viewpoint of religion aspect. True understanding of religion and true understanding of Brahmanism or the Brahmanical rites. If one is able to understand this, believe me, that is really going to be the root point for the classical dancer or the classical musician, or one who is practicing yoga, or one who is practicing meditation. To get to that highest self, first primary step of self-realization point. And this is the first step, or these are the primary steps that needs to be understood by a dancer when he or she is taking classical dance or classical music or yoga or meditation in his or her life. He needs to understand, he or she needs to understand this at a root level. Thus, I conclude this video with a positive note. Stay blessed. Have a blissful life. Shri Guru Bhyo Namah. May the Guru's grace be with one and all. Have a nice day ahead.